Transition Community Conference, WIT 2012, brought to you by the Winchester Multicultural Network in celebration of its 20 years building inclusive community. My name is Sahar Ahmed Auerbach, and I'm co-chair of the network.
And my name is Gloria Welch Lagle, Sahar's network co-chair.
So filled to the brim and overflowing. So glad you all came out this morning. So as Tahar introduced, I'm Mary Ann DeBlasi, and I moved here to Winchester when I was just about to turn 7 years old, all the way from Medford, Massachusetts. I was born in Medford, and I was born with a birth condition called spina bifida. And essentially, spina bifida is a partial paralysis from the waist down. It can be from very, very minor, don't even know you have it, to relatively severe. So it was very varying degrees. I typically walk with crutches, which these are not little flowers sticking out of my head. They're my crutches, but I also use a wheelchair when I don't want to go faster and further than I can walk with crutches. So I use my wheelchair today to represent my multi-mobility. So I grew up in Winchester, and my first school was that I attended elementary is Vincent Owen. And Vincent Owen, if you are aware of that school, was a school that was built on a hill with these two huge flights of stairs. And truly, why my parents ever built a house in a school district in Vincent Owen. Honestly, I wonder about that now as an adult. But when I was young, there was no ADA, there were no disability rights, there was no sense of a disability culture. And so what my parents' philosophy was, we treated you normal just like all the other kids. And that is how I grew up, is by adapting and accommodating to the environment around me. And so I don't even think it occurred to them that they were bringing their disabled daughter into a school with all these stairs. And I never thought of it either, just the way it was. So, and I lived more than a mile from the school, so that meant that I could walk to school, oh no, I'm sorry, we lived just under a mile from school, which meant that I couldn't take the bus. And it was also too far to walk. So the town at that time was very, very nice, like I said, before ADA. They offered to have a taxi pick me up every morning, take me to school, and bring me home again at the end of the day, which was really very aggressive on Winchester's part. There was no charge to my family. However, it also meant that I was separated from the other kids. All the other kids were walking to school, and I was passing them in a cab. And then when I got to school, I had to go up the flight of stairs inside the school where the teachers went while the kids were outside going up the stairs because there were no railings on the outside stairs, no railings on the inside. So my social isolation, really, as a child was pretty severe because of accessibility. And I'm just really thrilled to see an empty lot now with Vincent Owen. They've torn down the school, and they're going to be building a fully accessible school. So that was a childhood experience of growing up. And then I just went on to, of course, the high school, which is the new high school at the time. I'm aging, I'm really dating myself. And there was an elevator at the high school, which was fantastic. I went to Lynch, one level. So I was really actually very blessed that I was able to be in environments where I was mainstream, is the term that they use, to be integrated with the public school system. Went on to college, went to work, got my first apartment, and I moved all the way, my first apartment to Malden. Then I moved to Stone Oak, and then I moved back to Winchester, and I've been in Winchester for about 14 years. And each of those moves was because one of the criteria I was certainly looking for was a one-level, first-floor place to live, but it was not accessible housing. It was just living with everybody else. Just happened to be in a home that was that was one level for me. And that is what brought me back to Winchester, was the condos, the Willows on Upper Cross Street, because they were townhouses, but they're really unique. The whole first level of all the units are one level. So it was a really wonderful, accessible home for me to live in. And then a few years later, my parents, who were aging, decided to move there as well, which was a really smart move because my mom really needs one level living now. She's elderly, and as we say, everybody's temporarily able-bodied, and so she is certainly needing this home right now. I'm going to wrap up by saying, though, that one of the, it was actually in preparation for this talk that I actually became more consciously aware of what is almost automatic for me. When I'm going to a new place, whether it's a job, whether it's a social event here, wherever it is, automatically I'm thinking about, is there handicapped parking? Is there accessible? Is it stairs? Is there an elevator? And if I'm in my wheelchair, is there an accessible bathroom? I mean, so I'm thinking of all these things, and I just automatically ask these questions. And honestly, if there's a big flight of stairs, I can go upstairs. But very often, I'll choose not to because it's too much energy and too much wear and tear on my left knee, which is starting to give me problems. So I'll choose not to. When I'm in my wheelchair and going around town in Winchester, I have a new insight into just that one threshold, that one step to get into a store, into any kind of establishment that most people say, well, it's just one step, it's accessible. It's not. When you're in a wheelchair, it is not accessible. So there's a Mount Vernon Street, there's a lot of stores, Thompson Street, the whole section of the red brick building with bookends and the shoe store is, they're not accessible. There's a whole huge part of town that is not accessible if I'm in my wheelchair. However, when there is parking, when there is accessibility, to me, it's just this big, huge welcome sign in the window, and I feel welcome. Thank you.
Hello. My name is Malcolm Langston, and I'm a middle school sixth grade history teacher here in town. I've been here since 1993. I actually lived in Dollarville. And I was also a member of the Winchester Multicultural Network for many years. So when Sandy called me a couple months ago, I said, yeah, Sandy, not a problem. I can do this. Not a big deal. Glad to help out. And at the time, I was thinking, oh, it's just going to be like our network meetings in Sandy's house on the couch, nice and cozy with a couple of people. And then I started to see flyers with my picture on it, posters around town, high-definition commercials on TV, and then front-page articles yesterday. So I said, oh, great, looks like I'm under a little pressure. I'm glad to be here. I'm glad that all of you are here. I'm not going to really talk about myself, but I'm going to talk a little bit about my experience at the schools. And I'd like to start off with a short poem I found on diversity. It was at Boston Public Schools, and there was a contest on diversity for the students. And I picked a poem from a third grader. And when I saw the third grader's name, I said, oh great, this reminds me every summer of the last 17 years. When I first started here in Winchester, I could pronounce everyone's name when I got the roster in the summertime. You know, John O'Connell, Billy Smith, Megan Murphy, and as the years went on, you know, this summer 30% of the names I'm struggling with I can't pronounce. But as a social studies teacher, you know, I love that. I love to see the diversity in the classroom, kids sharing their ideas and the different perspectives that they bring to the classroom. So let me start with a poem, and this is from, I'm sure I'm mispronouncing his name, Abdur Man Abdulali, a third grader from the Joseph Hurley School in the South End of Boston. The title is Being Different. Being different is really kind of bad. Everybody is not my friend. I think they judge me because of my country. They say, could we, should we be his friend? But there is a no. I feel bad. There is no one to play with, eat with, or study with. All there is a funny, rude name. There is fun for everyone, but no fun for me, because I am different. And this is, with the sweetness of diversity, these are some of the struggles like Abraham is dealing with in the public schools. And as our schools become more diverse, we as teachers in public school are struggling to deal with the issues that diversity may bring. For example, at McCall, there are 27 languages spoken, 130 of the kids speak different languages at their home. And our teacher, Pam Carnes, told me yesterday, by 2025, one in four public school children will be ELL, English Language Learners. So it sounds that we have a lot of work to do to make our town and schools the best they can be. But we should also take time to enjoy the differences as we work and live together. Thank you.
We found a real estate agent online, narrowed our search down to two towns, Winchester and Lexington, and basically came up for a weekend of house hunting. We spent the entire day with the agent, going to more than a dozen houses. At some point during the day, the real estate agent felt the need to basically try to persuade me to pick a house in Lexington. She informed me that Lexington had a much larger Asian population, and we might be happier there. At the time, I was pretty surprised by what she had told us. At no point during the day did I inquire about the minority breakdowns in either town, nor mention that it was a factor in our house hunt. I didn't tell her, but I didn't know if she was trying to tell me that Lexington would be better for us simply because I'm Asian, or if there was something wrong with Winchester and that she was not elaborating on. As luck would have it, my husband and I found the only house on the market on our list that was new construction, and it was in Winchester. Because of that factor, we went with Winchester, and I'm so very glad that we did. We chose Winchester for being close to Boston and good schools and the new construction, but what we got was so much more. I've been so pleased to discover what a strong sense of community, family values, and caring for others that exists in Winchester. Joining the Family Action Network and participating in activities such as the Town Farmers Market, Bank of Fair, Town Day, and so forth, you really see what a tight community we have here. People and local businesses in town go out of their way to take the time to help others in the community. If there's a need, someone steps up to help out. Whether it's building a playground, a splash park, or a track with private funds, people spend their personal time to try to make it happen. If tragedy falls upon a family in town, people rally together to help in whatever way possible, whether it's bringing meals or organizing a fundraiser. It's even something as small as a fender bender. Last October, I was parked downtown in front of Pizza Express. I was going store to store to sign up businesses for the annual trick-or-treating event that Dan co-hosts with the Winchester Recreation Department. When I returned to my car, a young woman from the toy store came running across the street to me and handed me a piece of paper. She basically told me that a truck had hit the back of my parked car, moved up two spots, and the man went into CVS. While I was waiting for the police officer to arrive to take a police report about that, a second woman drove by, stopped, rolled down her window, and said, "Hey, that truck parked up there just hit your car." Basically, this guy did $2,000 in damage in my car, and if it wasn't for these folks stopping to help a complete stranger, I never would have known about it, because really, how often do you look at the back of your car when you're parked? Although I'm not a long-time resident as compared to some of my fellow panelists, even in the last 5 years, I've seen a noticeable increase in the number of minorities that have moved to town. I think this will only add to the richness and complexity of our community. In preparation for this conference, I spoke to parents at several Winchester preschools, the bulk of the family membership are the infant toddler set, and inquired about the multicultural activities in their schools. I'm pleased to report that all of the parents told me that their schools were trying to educate the students to embrace multiculturalism. Parents are invited to come in and make presentations. Holidays from around the world are celebrated and discussed. Food is sampled and crafts are made in conjunction with the presentations. When I look in the mirror, the first thing I see is not an Asian person. I just see me. When I go around town, I don't expect to be treated differently, and I don't feel that people in town do treat me differently. And maybe it's because I'm a first-generation American and English is my first language, but it just hasn't been my experience in town to be treated otherwise. I informally polled a few friends and found that they too did not feel that they or their kids are treated differently. Granted, I can't speak for everyone in town, but I'm glad to know that I'm not alone in my observations. I think kids learn by example, and if they don't see their parents treating others differently or being treated differently, they won't either. Learning about other people at school helps to expand their viewpoints. My daughter is very matter-of-fact when she says her friend Jacob celebrates Hanukkah and we have a Christmas tree. She knows that one of her grandmothers speaks Chinese and the other does not. It's not a big deal. It's just part of who she is, and I thank Winchester for reinforcing this. Thank you.
Good morning, my name is MJ Dolphin, and I'm, I guess, the newest Winchester resident. I've been here 2.5 years. In fact, my realtor is here, my Catherine, where we're sitting. And we came here from Jamaica Plain. For those of you who don't know where JP is, as we affectionately call it, it's in Boston. And it is beautifully diverse. But it is also a stressful place to live, and the school systems in Boston are pretty difficult to traverse. And so we had our son, I have two boys. I have Henry, who's 11, and William, who's 7. And I'm married. I've been married for 15 years to Chris. And so we decided that we needed to leave the city. We had our son, our older son, at Milton Academy, a wonderful school, but it is expensive. And two, there was going to be too much for us to afford. So we started looking, we spent a year looking, and we looked at 8 different towns outside of Boston. And we looked at towns that were sort of extraordinarily gay-friendly. Chris, by the way, is Christine, so I have a wife. Extraordinarily gay-friendly, but we're too overcrowded, too big for us. We wanted a smaller community. And for all the reasons that my panelists who, after hearing me today, I just feel a little humbled being here talking to you. For all the reasons that I think you chose Winchester, we chose Winchester. It's beautiful. I love that you can see the sky here. I love that I'm looking out the window, watching snowfall, and there's not a building that I'm seeing its trees. And it's also a place where education is valued, and we have felt very welcome. So I've loved it. But I thought today that it would help you, as you're listening this morning to all the stories, to hear a few stories from me about what it's been like for us. Some of which have to do with Winchester, and some maybe a little bit broader, but might help you have some at least some ability to see the world through my glasses. So when Chris and I came out, it was in the 90s. She has a wonderful family, as do I, and we are very close to her sister. Her sister has 4 children. And when we told her that we were gay, she said, "That's fine, but my children are innocent, and I do not want you telling them." And I thought, okay, well, that's going to be a little difficult, because we are together. But we didn't, and we respected that. We never talked to those children, and there are 4 of them, at the time they were 4, and between the ages of 4 and 10. We have never to this day had a real conversation with any one of those children, really real, about our family. 10 years later, we had a similar conversation. I'm sorry, this is awfully hard. Where a family member, a child in the family, was talking to our 4-year-old. And he said, Henry, my older son, must have said something about having his moms. And this cousin, Kevin, who we adore, and who Henry adores, he's a little bit older, and you know how that goes. You love your older cousins, it's wonderful. Karen said, you can't have two moms, Henry. It's impossible. Who's your dad? And Henry was 4 years old. He had no idea what to do with this, but he felt pretty badly about it. So he came to Chris and I, and he said, I don't know. What's wrong with us? And we went to Stephen Margie's parents, who, by the way, are the only family members who came to our wedding when we got married and toasted us. And they said, we have not talked to our children about this. They are innocent. And there's something about shame that comes with that word innocence. And we said, wow, well, so now Henry has to have this conversation. And we talked to Henry, you know, we're a strong family. Chris and I adore each other, and we adore our children. And we got through it, but I had no idea what Steve and Margie. We told them what we thought about that. They actually told us that their children were also blind to race in that conversation. And, you know, I can tell you right now, their child is blind to race. But that's a whole other conversation for later on today, hopefully. We still have a fabulous relationship with these people. These are our family, and we love them, and they do love us. It's just hard sometimes. 6 years later, we were living in Winchester last year, and a little boy in Henry's class, and he's now in the fifth grade, we go to Amrose, a little boy in his class said very loudly and very openly and kept asking, who is your father? You can't have two moms. Who is your father? And Henry came home to us, and he said, it's driving me crazy, Mom. I don't like this. I don't want to have to explain my family to my classmates. You know, most of the kids are pretty cool about it. So we said, you know, Henry, we'll try to talk to the mom. We'll figure it out. We happened to be lucky enough to be at the school where this little boy was there with his mom. And the little boy did it right in front of us. And he said, Henry, who's your father? I need to know. And his mom, I thought this was an awesome answer. His mom turned to us and she said, I went to Wellesley. It's all okay. And in essence, hate me. But I do feel like Winchester has been a place where even asking me to be on this panel today is a huge effort on the part of this community. And I think on behalf of all of us, and I do want to tell you just another quick story that for us, it's all about coming out all the time. I don't think that I look gay. If I was 5 inches shorter, maybe a little bit heavier, maybe had a few more piercings, and maybe had a buzz cut, maybe you'd say she could be, right? But I don't think I look like a lesbian. So when I'm chatting with moms all the time, because Winchester is a sports town, on the sidelines at some game or for some practice, we often get into conversations about our families, about our kids, about life, and inevitably, in a lovely way, and as they should, I'm asked about my husband. And there's a moment where I have to stop and I have to think about that. And I know I'm going to say, I don't have a husband. I have a wife. And there's going to be a moment, a pause, where their whole reality shifts. And thankfully, there's usually just a pause and a continuation of the conversation. Very, very rarely has it become uncomfortable. And in some cases, people will share their differences with me, and I am so honored and privileged to have that happen, because it bonds, literally bonds me to them. So I guess I leave you after hearing the stories today, and sort of what we all really want is, I think we all want to belong, don't we? When you think about what was so hard about high school, isn't it the times when you didn't feel like you belonged? You felt like another. I think that poem that Marvin read was beautiful. I have a quote from a young woman who's disabled. She lives in Canada, and I've been doing a lot of reading about belonging and difference over the past few weeks as I was asked to be on this. And I love this quote because I think it is so much about what this is all about. She says, to me, inclusion is belonging. It's being with everyone else and feeling a part of what they're doing. It is acceptance and knowing that you fit in. You're no different than any of the others. You feel safe, you feel secure, and you feel strong. You can be yourself. And I hope today, as we all go through these conversations and beyond, that we continue to make this a community where people feel safe and secure and strong. Thank you so much.